Well, Lionheart, this is not the best way to start the 200th vlog. At 10:30 last night, I hopped on a bus and went to San Francisco. And we're in San Jose on a stopover, and the bus broke down. So it's looking like it's going to be a two-hour wait for the replacement bus to come from Oakland and then for me to get to San Francisco. So I'm going to be like 2 or 3 hours off schedule. That is all fog. All right, an hour and a half late, but I am here. Welcome to San Francisco, guys. Well, the only downside to our trip today will be that there is no Jaw. Jaw is staying with Kevin. Check that out. First thing we're gonna do today, now that we've seen a bridge, I believe this is the Bay Bridge. We're gonna hop on the BART, the train. We're gonna go to AT&T Park, where the San Francisco Giants play. And here we are. AT&T Park. Let's go take a look. The great Gaylord Perry. Orlando Cepeda. You know, I've actually been to a game here. I've been here once before. Came and saw a Dodgers-Giants game. So Lionhearts, what you can expect in the next 2 days worth of vlogs, vlog 200 and 201, is everything that I like. You're gonna have sports, music, silent movie, 80s, 90s, 70s, it's all here. It's gonna be a great trip. Now because I have so much stuff to do, I'm not gonna be telling stories and all that stuff. I'm just gonna be showing you the sights like a tourist, guys. If it were open, I would definitely like to check out that Cooperstown, San Francisco exhibit, but it's closed. Too early. Johnny Cueto, former Red. Now, before I take off from here, I do wanna walk all the way around the building because I wanna show you guys the back. Coca-Cola is one of the main sponsors of this stadium, and they have a gigantic display in center field. Let's go see it. I can't believe Jason Schmidt has one. He was okay. I mean, he was good, but he wasn't like Hall of Fame caliber. Wow. Kind of surprised by both of these. Now, like that said, they first started in 1958 in San Francisco, playing the Dodgers at Seal Stadium. Then eventually you'd know them from Candlestick Park, the year that they were in the World Series, and the gigantic earthquake happened. And now they're here in AT&T Park. Stretch McCovey. There we go. That's what we wanted to see. The holy grail of it all. The Willie Mays Gate. Wow, what a tribute to history. Look at that, a shrine to Willie. The Say Hey Kid. All those golden gloves. And he's still a very active member of the San Francisco Giants family. You still see him at games, you still see him at anything that has to do with sometimes even drafts, or at least he used to. He goes to spring training. I mean, he's there, he's around. Now let's take a trip through the tree maze to see the Willie statue. And I'm happy to see that they have my one of my all-time favorite Reds, Johnny Cueto, is displayed up here, right above him. Of course, it's just to sell tickets, but Willie Howard Mays Jr. at all that history. Wow. Look at all that. That is awesome. Way to keep it classy. The unfortunate plight of a vlogger is having to manipulate sunlight into every shot you want. And there he is, the Dominican dandy, Juan Marichal. Who once during a Dodgers-Giants game didn't like a pitch that came inside, so he turned around and smashed the catcher on the head with his bat. Could have killed him. But believe it or not, they ended up becoming friends. I think it was Johnny Rosenberg or... I forget, what is that? That was the catcher of the Dodgers. He smashed him over the head with his bat, and like I said, yeah, they years later they made up and they would actually become lifelong friends. Here they've allowed fans to purchase a brick with their name on it that leads right around the entire park. And this is what's on the other side of the park. All those games when Barry Bonds was hitting home runs and you saw people out there in kayaks and stuff waiting for that ball to come flying over, that's where it was. As I was walking by, I noticed this, I had to stop. They actually have it so you can see into the field. They're redoing the grass and the grounds. Of course, nobody's here playing because they're all at spring training in Arizona right now. And here you can see the scoreboard and everything for the opposing teams when they do out of town games and the scores and stuff. And you can see up above it where they have some on the wall. How cool is that? And they are sure proud of their history. All up and down this outward walk, these little plaques are everywhere, memorializing every major accomplishment by a Giant. Many of them, Barry Bonds. Barry Bonds and Willie Mays, of course. 715th home run. The one that pushed him past Babe Ruth. I watched that All-Star game. Ichiro hit a in-the-park home run. See? I told you, most of them are probably going to be Barry Bonds. I know my baseball. Now, Barry Bonds is an extremely controversial and polarizing character in baseball. And mainly, I mean, they're starting to let in all the guys who were accused of steroids, but the real reason he's not getting in is because he was a jerk. And he was one of my favorite players for a long time when I was growing up, but it's just been commonly reported that he was a jerk to all the writers, and the writers are the ones who get to nominate in the players who go into the Hall of Fame, so I think they're just punishing him. This is where the Coke bottle sign is back here. And a little bit of nature never hurt anybody. We got a seal statue, and some pigeons, and a fishing pier. Pretty cool grounds. I would love for my grandpa and I to go to a game out here. He's the entire reason I love baseball. There's the Coke. There's the giant Coke bottle. Let's get over there. I had to take the long way around because they have it all gated up that whole way around. But there's a, you can see there's a baseball glove and a Coke bottle. Originally, this was gonna be the very last stop on my entire trip. But I got to thinking, what better way to see the sun come up than at this park? And unfortunately, I wasn't in San Francisco when the sun came up, but I still want to come here first. And there it is. During games, that Coke bottle's lit up. Wow, what a sight it is to see. See, they even have the gates open. They're doing all the grounds maintenance. I wish I could just walk in there and look. There it is. Now let's get out of here. Next stop, Haight-Ashbury. That is a big heart-shaped olive. I'm gonna get some coffee before we go. They're all baseball themed. That's hilarious. Some of them have bats. Some of them have baseball gloves. coffee, and I'm heading off to Haight-Ashbury. Check out that decoration. Cool.
If you're wondering why or how I chose San Francisco for my trip, bus ticket was $1 to get here. Return trip, $34. And since the bus broke down, they're going to refund me my dollar. They're going to refund me my first trip. But I just figured I could do so much stuff here, and more than any place else, so let's do it.
Now guys, I am no expert on San Francisco. I have only been here literally one time in my life for about a day and a half with my friend Carrie to see a concert. I just walked past this. I thought it was worth stopping for. This is where once the birthplace of Jack London was. Call of the Wild. Of course, the fire of 1906. Most of the history that we're going to run across today has something to do with the earthquake of 1906. Now there's no way I'm going to be able to hit everything that I wish I could in one day. But I'm sure going to give it a whirl. I was smart enough to pick in advance about 30 places that I wanted to go, and I mapped it all out, and I took about 5 of those off so that this would be more doable. So I hope you guys enjoy this day. It'll actually be 2 vlogs, of course, but it'll all be one day for me. You can tell we're in the world of cable cars. I used an old couch to make a statement. None of us are gonna make it out of here. Well, I made it over here to Golden Gate Park in Haight-Ashbury. And this is the first stop that I wanted to make. This house right here has been here since 1904. And it's one of the few houses that actually survived the 1906 disaster. But where it really comes into play into the people that watch my vlog and why I'm here is this was the Jefferson Airplane House. From what I understand, they bought this house in 1968. They may have actually lived in here before they bought it, because the way that I found out they lived here, 2400 Fulton, is they released an album in 1987 called 2400 Fulton. And it was all songs that they wrote while they lived here. And they had stuff from Surrealistic Pillow, stuff from Volunteers. But they bought this house in 1968, and they let their entire circus of weirdos and friends and bands come and move in anytime they want. It was 3 floors. Grace Slick and Paul Cantor presided over this circus, and they actually, as soon as they moved in, they painted it black, installed a recording studio in it, and would just let anybody live in it that there was room for. And I love this, it's now been repainted. And they actually owned this from 1968 or even possibly 67, all the way up until the mid-80s when they finally sold it. And that's when they, I think they divulged where it was, because they called that album 2400 Fulton. But what was kind of cool about this is that when the Blues Brothers did one of their few and only tours, they stayed here with the band. So how cool is that? Jefferson Airplane House. Wow, that is a big house. Now let's go to Golden Gate Park. Wow, somebody in this apartment is a fan of my favorite street artist, Space Invader. And in case you guys didn't know, that's where Ja got his middle name. His name is Ja Space Invader. And we're gonna take this little path all the way under the bridge into Golden Gate Park, where the Human Bee Inn was, where the Love-Ins were. Cave in here. Well, I mean, it literally pretty much is a cave. Now this park is massive. And I'm not exactly sure which particular section of the park it was all taking place at. But let's pretend it was here. And the Human Bee Inn was like, that was like the pinnacle, the start of the Summer of Love, 1967. It was when Timothy Leary did the Tune In, Turn On, Drop Out. And you know what's crazy about this? The Human Bee Inn, The two guys who wrote the musical Hair were actually here to kind of submerge themselves in the lifestyle and live it as close as possible so that they could write Hair. And they said it was just, we just felt it was something that had to be done. Otherwise, only pictures and interviews would survive. We wanted to create something that would capture the essence of the time. And so you would have seen 30,000 people in Golden Gate Park for that love-in, that human be-in, where everybody was experimenting with free love, drugs, mind expansion, in the hopes that it would lead people to create their own utopias, to share and to all be one. And in the end, that's not exactly what ended up happening. There's the original amoeba. But I can go there in LA. I think it's safe to say this place has been here since the beginning. Nothing's really open yet over here. Look at all the influences over there. Kind of funny they would have David Bowie because he refused to play San Francisco for most of his career. This is what Haight Street looks like these days. And like I said, nothing's really open yet. But this is where it all happened in the 60s, baby. 67 to 69, this was it. There we go. They're proud of Jerry over here. Guys, in about 3 minutes, I'm gonna be at the Grateful Dead house. How amazing is that? Look at the old architecture of these old Victorian houses. You know what's cool is that basically what happened was a lot of the houses that you'll see in San Francisco are painted like gray. And it's because of World War I, they were trying to support the war effort and they were basically making everything look military. Painting all the buildings gray and putting like tarp and different stuff around it. I don't know if they thought maybe there was gonna be an invasion over here or what, but in the 60s, that's when all the people that lived down here decided they were gonna start livening them up, the houses, repainting them, changing the colors. You can tell this has really kind of become a big tourist attraction, even though there's nobody really out here yet. I wasn't gonna buy much anyway. But you can tell it's mostly all just stores. Little mushrooms. Well guys, here it is, Haight-Ashbury, the corner, where so much of history started, took place, and all those memorable Grateful Dead photos that I'm gonna post right here were taken. You know what's interesting is that when Zack Comics was started, that would make R. Crumb famous by publishing his work, they would sell it here on this corner out of a baby stroller. And R. Crumb said this was the corner where he kind of came up with a lot of the ideas for what he would end up doing for art, because he said he saw the ugliness on these streets. He said, all I saw was a bunch of older guys with nothing going on, nothing to do, waiting for women to bring them food. And he said he thought that it was, that whole movement was just an excuse to take advantage of the youth, and that people like Timothy Leary were just absolutely full of crap. And he thought that they were just out there to sleep with young girls. And I'm gonna post them, but all the Grateful Dead photos that were taken here. I mean, this was the hub of it. And even R. Crumb said really what killed the whole movement was they popularized it so much that people from everywhere were coming out here, and it was just
drugs were taking over, overpopulation, theft. It brought out all the worst. The more people that came here, and it just ended up pushing all the artists out of the colony. Now this purple address right here, 635 Ashbury. This was Janis Joplin's house when she was in Big Brother and Holding Company. And like I said, that movement, people started repainting the colors of the houses so they weren't gray, like the ones beside it. And this was her place. And I actually have a photo of her. Right at the corner of this street, and I'm gonna push it in right here. It's a pretty big building. There it is. Man, former address of Janis Joplin. Dude, I am here. The Grateful Dead house. If you ever wondered how this came to be, basically what happened was when the band was getting started and they were getting noticed in this area, their managers actually managed this building as well and ran the band's operations out of here. So what they decided to do was they started conveniently finding reasons to evict the tenants, and every time a tenant would be evicted, they would move in another member of the Dead. In this house, Jerry Garcia, Bob Weir and Neil Cassidy shared a room together. Pigpen, the whole band, all their hanger-ons. And they lived here for like 2 years until there was a sting drug bust in 1967. And when the feds decided to do it, they brought like the media and cameramen and made a huge ordeal out of it. They busted most of the guys for marijuana possession, of course. And the guys just felt like it was just becoming too much of a commercialized area, and so they decided to move out. But this is like holy grail to me. Like, I am such a Grateful Dead fan. There's so many bands that I love, and Grateful Dead is not my favorite band, but it's a band that you can put on any era, and you will magically just get whisked away into a world however your imagination wants it to be fantasized. I personally love Blues for Allah, that's my favorite, but you really can't go wrong with any of it. I discovered him when I was in junior high. I was watching MTV and they played the Touch of Grey video and I was hooked. Now I'm gonna insert right here a myriad of photos of the band members in various forms and all their friends piling out onto this. The gate wasn't there, but the house was not this purplish color. But man, God, wouldn't I love to be in that house just once. So cool. And whoever wins the sunglasses, your sunglasses have been on the Grateful Dead house. Right across the street was the house that Alton Kelly and Stanley Mouse lived in. And they were actually the guys who made most of the psychedelic posters for the band in that day. All their venue posters. And they created the Skull and Roses Grateful Dead logo. Many of the album covers. And one of the legends to this house, and they credit it also to the house next door right here, is that while the Grateful Dead lived here, it was also the Hell's Angels house. And there's a story about Ken Kesey, who was big in the acid scene, was cruising down this street one day and his brakes quit working. And this is just a legend. I'm sure it probably didn't happen, but cruising down this street and was losing control, and there was a car pulling out, and he either had to crash into the Grateful Dead house, which is right there, or the Hell's Angels house, which is right here, one of these two.
Some say 7:15, some say 7:19. But he said he picked the Hell's Angels house because he thought that it would cause less damage as far as like the social scene. Probably a good decision for us Grateful Dead fans. But think of that. The Skull and Roses art was created in there. All those Live at the Fillmore, Winterland, Golden Gate Park, all those shows, all those show posters would have been created here, as well as the Hell's Angels living here. As we head to our next stop and we leave the Grateful Dead house in that area, I forgot to tell you guys something that I wanted to mention while I was in Golden Gate Park, is that they actually were going to throw a 50th anniversary Lovin', Human Bein', at Golden Gate Park, and the city decided not to approve the permit. It was supposed to happen this coming June, and they found out February 10th that they were going to be denied. Two doors down from the Grateful Dead house, this is in their window. I wonder if they would have bought the Grateful Dead house instead of this one had it been available. Pretty cool. Check out that original stained glass. That thing is old. I'm telling you, standing here in person, that's got to be early 1900s when this house was built. I love the houses in this area. And if you're wondering why they're all like so compacted together, it's once again because of the 1906 earthquake. So many places were damaged, they decided to start clumping them and grouping them together so that they wouldn't be able to fall, or theoretically. Now let's go to our next destination. Well, our next rock and roll house is not somebody from the Love Inn era. The Summer of Love. This was the home of Sid Vicious from the Sex Pistols. And he actually lived here. Right when the band concluded his last tour, he moved here, had an overdose here, didn't die, save that for New York. But this was his house. Fighting the sun here, but it's kind of crazy how many people live within like, or lived within a block of each other. And there it is. 32 Delmar. That would have been his door right there in the upstairs. Cool. One of my goals for this trip was to do as much walking as possible. What I ended up doing was, as soon as I got off the bus, I hopped on the train about a mile to AT&T Park, because when you buy a fare there, you get a free transfer that lasts for like hours. And I knew that my very next stop from there was by train was 30 minutes, so I couldn't walk that. So the only thing that I'm not gonna be walking was what we've already seen. My train ride to AT&T Park, and then my train ride over to Haight-Ashbury. I got dropped off about a block away from the Jefferson Airplane House, and I've just been walking ever since. I decided to break this vlog up into like two, like I told you, and I broke it into like, since I'm doing four sections of things today, two and two. So we only have a few more stops on this one, and then I'm gonna give away these sunglasses. Check out this place. They have tripped it out. I think I'm gonna have to go in there. Even though I know how to make my own tie-dye. Oh, see, here's kind of a, kind of what I was telling you, the 50th anniversary. Love on Hate. Let's go in there. Wow, so cool. Look at that Jerry Garcia up there. You cannot find these anywhere else. That is so cool.
We have our fashion show mirror behind you.
Look at the Jerry stuff. That's so cool. And whoever wins the sunglasses, I just bought you a little something in this store that's gonna go with those sunglasses. I did just buy myself a new belt, a Grateful Dead belt, because the selling point on it was, she said it comes with a 20-year warranty. You can just mail it back and they'll send you a new one. Presuming they're in business, that's a good deal for me, because I go through belts about every 6 months. free giveaway.
Wow. Check this place out. Jeez.
That is really something.
That is absolutely correct. And that's the way every single one of you should look at your life. If you wonder why I do these adventures and why I don't really care if I'm poor or I'm rich, it's because my dad died when he was 39. My stepdad had brain cancer before the age of like 33. I think he was 30. My grandmother died of leukemia. I mean, it's just one of those things that life is not guaranteed to last any amount of time, and you have to enjoy it when you can. And the hills in this town are no joke, but we're pretty close to our next rock and roll house. We are close. Look at these gates. Wow. And I'm pretty sure those gates belong to where we're looking for. Yep. Right there. 737. This, in the late 60s, was the home of Graham Nash from Crosby, Stills, and Nash. And in this house, he put in a recording studio while he lived here. The band recorded here. They practiced here. And he also would take in some of the local bands and help them by recording their music as well. A couple of those were Steve Miller Band, Quicksilver Messenger Service, and of course, Crosby, Stills, and Nash. There's a lot of cars in front of the house, so I'm trying to give you the best view possible, but that crazy Munsters looking gate was his gate. One thing I am very happy about is that when I bought these tickets, I had no idea what the weather would be like, and I checked the weather this week and it said today was gonna be a little chilly, 63, but tomorrow it was gonna rain, so I lucked out on that one. And guys, I really hope you're enjoying what I'm doing with my time. This is what I would do on a day trip to San Francisco, and I'm just taking you along with me. There are parks everywhere in San Francisco. So every once in a while, as I'm walking around and I'm making really good time, I just stop off for a little hike and I roam around. For somebody who's squeezing in like 25 things in one day, I sure am doing a good job of it right now. Just stumbled upon this massive stump. That thing is huge. It's easily 4 foot long. I'm standing on the stump! This is kind of interesting. This is the William McKinley statue at the base of Panhandle Park. I'm all the way down that far south, and the only reason this is here, there's no significance to him in San Francisco. They said he only even came through San Francisco once on his campaign trail. It was just because San Francisco was having fun with this statue boom at one point, and McKinley had just been assassinated after only serving 6 months in office, and so they decided to erect a statue for him. And the sculptor decided not even to model it after McKinley, he was just gonna model it after like the mental toughness and traits of the people of America. So it's kind of just a statue in name only. There's a little face of him up here, but yeah. Lion faces and Michael Jordan cardboard cut out with a Santa hat. Coolest neighbors in the world. Well, we made it to the last stop on today's vlog. Well, other than me probably getting something to eat, but we're at the Fillmore. This is the original Fillmore. A man named Charles Sullivan, a black business owner, owned it and used to throw some jazz shows and had a permit here. Bill Graham wanted to throw like a mime show and needed a permit, so he talked this guy into letting him rent it out,
And that was basically the start of Bill Graham's productions, this Bill Graham Presents. And I mean, this place, the Grateful Dead played here 51 shows from 1965 to 1969. This was basically where Bill Graham spawned the entire counterculture psychedelic movement. The Allman Brothers played here, Creedence Clearwater played here, The Doors, Hendrix, Big Brother and Holding Company, The Grateful Dead, Frank Zappa, Quicksilver Messenger Service, Steve Miller Band, who am I forgetting? Pretty much anybody who came out of the 60s started here. And this was also where Velvet Underground and Nico debuted their crazy trippy slideshow with the acid wax and the crazy freak out dancers that Andy Warhol designed. That all was started here. Now they've moved the entrance over to this side over here, but this was the original start of it. And I know a lot of people think that the Allman Brothers cover Live at the Fillmore East and Live at the Fillmore, that was not even here. That cover actually wasn't even at a Fillmore location. But this was it. Most of the music that came out of the 60s that we all know and love started here, thanks to Bill Graham. He would go on eventually to open the Fillmore East, the Fillmore West, but this was always the classic location. This has been here since 1912. First it was called the Majestic Theater, and then it became called the like Ambassador Skating Rink or Skating Club. And until Charles Sullivan opened up that his kind of jazz club. But even when Bill Graham ran it, he also had Lenny Bruce perform here, Otis Redding, Aretha Franklin, and numerous poets. Wow, what an insane piece of history, huh, guys? Unbelievable. If you love counterculture psychedelic music like I do, this place was the place. I would have loved to have seen a show here. This spawned that whole 60s movement. The original ticket booth and that original doorway, the original entryway. I'm sure it's changed since the original time. Wow. All right, while we're at the Fillmore, the winner of my Vlog 200 sunglasses that I've worn for the last 100 days is April Eastman. Your idea was awesome. It's the MGM Lake in Culver City that's in the Raintree condominiums. And there's a big story there. I'm gonna try and get it and vlog that. Notable mention, Mark Potter had a great idea. Unfortunately, I can't do it because it's past 3 years. He wanted me to do the Phantom of the Opera set that was on one of the Universal sound stages for years and years and years, but they dismantled it 3 years ago. Otherwise, that probably would have won it. All right, guys. Thanks for watching my 200th vlog. Come back tomorrow and see what I did with the rest of my day. And your sunglasses will have also been at the legendary Fillmore. Now, the funny thing will be if you absolutely hate 60s music, but either way, I love it. So, there you go. Oh, from San Francisco, California, it's Jordan the Lion saying goodbye.